I'm Spiro with SP Wood Art, and thank you for joining me here today. This may turn out to be a jig, hopefully, that this will assist me later on in making my segmented handle for the screwdriver. Making your own screwdrivers is great. The handles are the most comfortable you'll probably ever own. My wife absolutely loves this one because, well, it's Purple Heart and eucalyptus and looks nice, but they're really of high quality. I've had this one for years and have never had a problem with it. I'm gonna try and add a segmented flare to it. One a little bit more complicated than just this three-piece segmented. So I hope you stick around to the very end and enjoy the show. So I've searched around in my scrap bin and found these three pieces of wood that I feel will complement each other and have a nice contrast. This is a piece of Bikoti wood. It's very beautiful. And one side needs to be flat. Here is a piece of hard maple that also needs two sides to be flattened out, along with this piece of Bobinga. Since there wasn't a lot to take off, I just used my belt sander to clean all these edges up, and it has a really nice fit between the joints. You can use a planer if you'd like to. So before I start the gluing process, I want to share with you a little tip. I use a pair of pliers and I crimp the end of this metal on the acid brush, and it helps to hold the bristles in when you glue so you don't have any bristles come out and get stuck in your gluing. And there's no particular reason why I'm using Type Bond 3 other than this bottle is a little old and I'm trying to use up the glue. I also put glue on the sides. I'd also like to mention that each of the strips and grains are in contrasting orientation to help with any swelling. Then, after I've used an excessive amount of clamps, I will wait for the glue to cure for 24 hours. Then I'll remove all of the clamps and inspect the joints, make sure there's no gaps or any issues. Next, I'll try to square up the blank to help with the drilling. Now I'm going to mark the center of each of the blanks, and I'm going to use the intersection points of the lines or the joints. I'm not going to actually use a center finder because you want to make sure that those joints are in the middle of your drill hole. Now you can continue on to drill the three holes that the PSI directions state, but I'm going to take that one step further and add some more segmenting. So I've divided out the blank in 8 equal parts, including all the kerf cuts from the 1/8 inch saw blade I have. If you want more than 8 segments, you'll have to have a longer blank to start with because of all the kerfs. And here I'm just numbering each of the sections so I can keep them aligned later on after I make the cuts. At this point, I will now add up each of the kerfs for each of the drill sections to accommodate for each of the kerf cuts within each of the drill sections. Except for the last drill hole, which is a 1/8 inch drill bit that I'm using, that is required to be an inch deep, and that's plenty to accept the 1/4 inch peg on the end cap. You'll also want to make sure that you drill a 90 degree hole to make sure that your joint lines later on won't come out crooked when you turn your handle. So the directions suggest that you use a 5/8 inch Foster bit, which I do, and that the hole be 1 1/16 inch deep. But I will extend that to 1 3/16 inch to accommodate 1 1/8 inch kerf. For the second drill hole, the directions recommend a 3 3/4 inch hole depth, and I need to accommodate 5 1/8 inch kerf cuts, which is 4 3/8 inch total depth. For the third drill hole, I'll set my depth to 1 inch, flip the blank, and drill a hole with a 1/8 inch brad point bit. Then I'll check the hole depths to make sure they came out to the proper length. Now I'll move over to my table saw, and I'm using my crosscut sled to align these kerfs with the cut on my crosscut sled. And then I'll make several cuts. And this is why I love having a table saw sled with a clamping jig. I can cut very small pieces accurately and safely, and my hands are nowhere near the blade. So if you don't have a table saw sled, I highly recommend building one. Then I'll just double check to make sure all my measurements came out properly to accommodate all the 1/8 inch kerf cuts. And it came out really nice. Now you just have to decide on the design, which you can have a checkered pattern, a half checkered pattern, or a split checkered pattern, or a hard twist pattern, or a medium twist pattern, or a double directional twist pattern, or a slight twist pattern, which is kind of what I might go for. Here we will use the numbers that we wrote on there earlier to make sure that the pieces are properly aligned and in order. So to ensure that each of your segmented pieces will not move around during the gluing process or while the glue is curing, you can now use that little jig that you saw me create in the beginning of this video. I'd also like to note that the dowel or the dowel jig does not go all the way through. It stops just before the last two segmented sections. And those last two segmented sections are just for the 1/8 inch drill hole. And this is why I wanted a little bit of the dowel sticking out of the front of the handle, so I can use a clamp to hold the dowel in place while I glue the segments together. I'm also going to leave the dowel in place to help with stabilizing the segments. I really don't want them to move around with the clamping, and hopefully it won't glue in. I also made this little scrap hardboard jig to assist me in the segment rotations to have them somewhat even with each other. You don't have to use one of these, but I think it helps. And those last two segmented pieces, I just eyeballed the centers. Now I'll just clean up any excess glue that I don't want on my clamps, and then I'll let it set for 24 hours to cure. Well, unfortunately, the dowel did get glued in, and that's okay, so it's become a sacrificial or a one-time use jig. And here, for the first time, I'm going to use my oscillating spindle sander and slash belt sander just to clean up the corners on the blank. That way they don't have any catches on the lathe. And you could definitely use a different method, like a bandsaw or a handsaw instead of a sander. Now, I will use the same Fosner bit and brad point drill bit that I used earlier and drill out the sacrificial jig. And an important note at this stage is that when you're drilling the depths, you'll be using the actual measurements from the directions, not the multiplied or added kerf depths. And one more time, we'll make sure that the depths came out to the proper lengths. Now, using some 5-minute epoxy, I'm going to glue in the actual inside ferrule nut that will hold in the screwdriver bit shafts. And I also filled in some of the gaps, and then I let this sit for another day. So here I'm using a 1-inch spindle roughing gouge to turn the blank round. And this is kiln dried wood, so it's really dry and dusty. And don't do as I do as I say. Remove all your jewelry before turning, it's just safer, and I always forget to remove my wedding band. Then, after your blank is round, I'll take my hand and kind of find the high and low points of my hand to give me a general guideline of how to shape the handle so it's comfortable. Then I'll just dive right into shaping the handle using my guidelines that I just made, and I'm using a round carbide cutter. Or a finishing cutter, they call it sometimes. Now, before I go any further with the handle shape, I'm going to cut out the ferrule diameter and just mark a line for the right width. And then I'll just use a parting tool to get down to close to the depth, and then I'll keep checking it and then removing away material until I reach the desired diameter. Oh, and once I got close to the diameter, I switched over to a square nose scraper so that I can have a nice 90-degree angle. Then I moved back to my round carbide cutter and finished shaping the profile of the handle. Next, I'll just lightly touch up the ends of the handle before I add the same 5-minute epoxy to the brass ferrule for the handle. And then I'll let that cure for a day. And while I'm waiting for that glue to cure for a day, I can polish up the end cap. Then I'll also trace out the end cap to help me with carving out the profile later. Here I just mounted the end cap onto a Jacob's chuck, and make sure you use a drawbar to secure the Jacob's chuck and your headstock. And to polish the brass, I'm starting with 150 grit and working my way up to 600 grit sandpaper. Then I'll skip to a 2000 grit kind of polish. Then I'll finish up with a Scotch-Brite pad, and that'll take all the swirl marks out. Then, once again, when the glue is dry, I will continue to shape the handle, including tapering the end to bring it closer to the end cap. And this is why I traced out the end cap earlier with a pencil. Here I started off using a 1/8 inch thin parting tool to try and clean up some of the glue from the ferrule where it met the wood, but it didn't work as well as I hoped, so I switched over to a detailed spindle gouge, and that worked out a lot better. Got right into the tight corner. I'll also use 150 to 600 sandpaper, then 2000, then the Scotch-Brite pad to polish up the brass ferrule. Make sure you don't cross-contaminate the brass with the wood, or else your hard maple could turn a little gray. I also use some alcohol, rubbing alcohol, to clean up some of the pitch and resin left behind by the sanding. Next, I'll mask off with some painter's tape the brass ferrule so I don't get any of the polyurethane finish on the brass, before loosely mounting the handle on a wooden dowel. Then I'll merely apply the wipe-on polyurethane with a shop towel. Make sure you use rubber gloves and apply liberally. So about 4 hours later, the directions say 2 to 3 hours, but I let it cure for 4. And I will sand the polyurethane with this Scotch-Brite in-between sanding sponge that I bought specifically for sanding in between coats, and it works really well. I'll also wipe off any dust with a dry paper towel. Then apply a second and third coat with the same procedure. Now, after 24 hours has passed from the final coat, I will remove the painter's tape, and then I'll add some more epoxy to the end cap and let that dry for another 24 hours. And the last step is to magnetize the screwdriver tips. I do this with any of my screwdriver kits. And you can buy these at any home store.
Since there's a lot of prep work, this is a great project to have while you're doing another project. So you can work on it, let it glue, do something else in between. The handle came out really nice. I'm very happy with it. The design is neat. The fit is very comfortable. It's really, really comfortable. The finish came out nice with 3 coats of poly, and I don't think I mentioned this before, but it's water-based polyurethane. I may, after a week or so, decide to go back and buff this out with a 3-step polish or wax. So as always, stay safe in your shop. Thank you for watching, and please subscribe.